having been not just for this occasion, but for several months actually, and I hope to make more contacts and engage in discussions than I have done so far, although there have been some. Thank you, Philip, for your very flattering introduction, on which I think I do not have to comment in any way. So, this is work in progress. I'm very interested in your responses and comments and questions and criticism. The simple facts to start with is that growth rates in the OECD world, economic growth rates in the OECD world, are in decline. Second, in order to restore economic balances after the crisis of 2008, and in particular in order to restore the viability of the European Union and the euro system, much more economic growth is needed, which is a universal consensus among all parties involved and all experts. And third, we don't know how to achieve it, and whether it is at all desirable, apart from feasible, to achieve it. So this oxymoronic situation, something is missing, it is needed, but we don't know how to get there, is my starting point. And the only ambition that I have is to present you a complete picture with all the major positions in the debate. And that is relatively easy, because there has been a lot of literature which is itself symptomatic in the social sciences on topics such as the headwinds to growth, secular stagnation, and so on. So the an outpouring of analytical and empirical and normative and work that tries to look into the future, and I'm using some of this in my lecture. The core issue I wish to address is the issue of economic growth, understood as a long-term average increase of GDP per capita. Just 20 minutes ago, a friend from Germany sent me a quote from today's Allgemeine Zeitung. And it read that wages are increasing rapidly in Germany. And the proof was that for the first time since 2000, real wages, or for the first time since 2000, real wages have reached the level of 2000. So this is the drop in 15 years, stagnation of real wages. So this is proof of things are turning. The technical definition of growth of per capita GDP is growth of labor productivity multiplied by hours of gainful activity per capita. The first proposition I want to argue is that growth, thus defined, is a functional necessity concerning the smooth operation of the three institutional sectors that are affected by it. First, the sector of private investment and profit-generating enterprises. Second, the household sector, consisting of the recipients of wage and other incomes and transfers. And the third, the state sector, which extracts revenues. The overall volume of which depends on the rate of economic growth. All of these three sectors depend for their orderly functioning on growth that has already taken place in the past. That is the previous period of economic activity. Yet in a forward-looking perspective, growth must not only be experienced as a fact of the past, continue in the future, thus constituting a reflexive loop of self-fulfilling expectations, often known as business confidence. In the absence of minimally favorable long-term growth expectations, private sector investment does not make sense. At the micro level of investors, similarly, in the absence of economic growth, a growth rate that is sufficient to compensate for ongoing productivity gains, wage workers have reason to fear that their employment and or level of real income, which in turn will make investors fear for the level of demand that can make their investment profitable. Also, state revenues as a dependent variable of economic growth or fiscal growth dividends, they limit the scope of costly public policies as opposed to policies licensing, for instance, same-sex marriage, which is not costly. In short, the functioning of a capitalist democracy is contingent on the experience and the expectation of ongoing positive sum gain. All sides in the long run are going to gain and have reason to expect gains. Economic growth has been the great peacemaker. It's low here, and so I have to.
If you put the microphone more in your direction.
Is that better? Yes. Economic growth has been the great peacemaker in the history of democratic capitalism, and in particular in post-war Western political economies and societies, as well as in emerging market economies of the brick world, where economic growth even seems to make the adoption of democratic and rule of law institutional patterns partly dispensable as a basis of regime legitimacy and stability. Democratic capitalism has been compared to the, among others, by my friend Philippe Schmitten, to a bicycle. If it comes to a standstill, it falls. The triplet of capitalist modernization, privatized consumerism and households, and welfare state protection and provision epitomizes the triumph of growth-based social and political stability, or the fundamental social contract of democratic capitalism. Restoring, maintaining, and promoting economic growth is also, and virtually unanimously so, among analysts from all political camps, claimed to be the only way out of the current economic political crisis of the EU, and in particular the Eurozone. Economic policy controversies are not over the necessity and desirability of growth, but its feasibility, whether it can be achieved through the triplet of policies consisting in the first, the supply of liberalizing structural reforms aiming at lowering labor costs and transfers. Second, fiscal austerity and the relief of tax burdens on investors and enterprise. And thirdly, the provision of ever more cheap money to stimulate investors' demand for investment goods and labor and subsequently households' demand for goods and services, as well as state-generated demand for public investment and public services. What is contested is not the idea of economic growth, but the right mix of incomes, fiscal and monetary policy to make it happen. On either side of these increasingly vehement and bitter controversies on the ways to make it happen, the desirability and also the possibility of growth being restored have not been in doubt at both the official levels of political elites and at the level of academic economics. It is this so far solid consensus that is now breaking up. The solid consensus on the feasibility, desirability, and manageability of economic growth that is showing now widening cracks since the mid-2000s, roughly coinciding with the experience of the financial market and subsequent economic crisis in 2008, known as 9/15, 2008, and the climate change crisis that virtually everywhere has in steeply moving up the scale of political priorities at the national and global levels over the past decade. Empirically, the bad news is that the capitalist democracies of the OECD world show a clear long-term trend of approximating a pattern of zero growth. And one more to that effect. No? Okay, this is how Bob Gordon sees the world in a very long-term perspective. Economic growth starts in seriously somewhere in the mid-19th century. And that is the development and the predicted decline. And throughout human history, or the history of economic activity, economic growth is here depicted as a very short and transitory period, an anomaly that comes and soon will go. This is a graph from the Robert Gordon first paper, the 2012 paper, that has an enormous impact in that debate. But during the early years of post-2008 financial market and economic crisis, it was widely held by elites of economic policy and academic economics that poor growth performance of capitalist democracies was to be seen as a temporary and transitory phenomenon. A tipping point and a side switch of that view occurred in a number of publications coming out in 2013. And again, Robert Gordon is one of the protagonists of this argument, as is Larry Summers, and in Europe, Wolfgang Steg, and this is now all available in a volume edited by Dorings and Baldwin in September last year. By that first intellectual, the title is Secular Stagnation, was this. By the first intellectual response to the near zero growth experience in the OECD world was attributed to what I quote, globalization, saying basically growth is taking, is dislocated, is taking place elsewhere, namely in China and India, where 55% of total growth have taken place, global growth have taken place in 2011. There were soon to be added other endogenous, presumed causes of secular stagnation affecting economies on both sides of the North Atlantic. As we now widely used, as the now widely used term, secular stagnation suggests, the condition thus described is not only a measurable reality to be recognized as such, it is secular because there is little that can be done about it in terms of economic policy to overcome it, given the post-crisis configuration of macroeconomic parameters to which I now come. The best economic science can hope to do is to explain the new post-growth condition and its intractability. The instruments of monetary policy appear to be blunted by the widely deplored fact that flooding markets with cheap money does not translate, contrary to textbook wisdom, and given the extreme level of indebtedness for which growth has been funded in the past, it cannot be translated into more demand by households, business, and states, but to either the formation of speculative bubbles in asset markets and or a priority for repaying debt rather than buying consumption items, services, or investment goods, which might cause future growth, employment, and increments in consumption demand. High debt leads firms to invest less and consumers to consume less. And this is an argument that Wolfgang Steg has used to make a strong to defend a strong proposition, namely capitalism has run its course. Excessive indebtedness suffocates economic dynamics. Let me get this. Okay, this is just one impressive graph that shows household behavior in Britain. And the upper line is the household debt in percentage of British GDP. And this is slightly over 100% by now. But at the same time, savings, household savings are going down. Households are indebted in a way that they cannot afford to incur further debt. Okay. As cheap money does not boost inflation, but even fails to counteract deflationary pressures, it results in a situation where consumers and investors find it rational to wait rather than to invest and consume, which is the feature of deflation, particularly as in the absence of any alleviation of debt burdens through inflation. Getting rid of debt seems a clear potential priority. The first thing highly indebted economic entities will do with cheap money is thus try to reduce their liabilities, that is their negative savings they have done in the past. It is an economic puzzle that two market mechanisms of self-correction have so far obviously failed to operate. For one thing, the rise in overall, that is household, enterprise, state, indebtedness has not resulted in debt becoming more expensive through rising interest rates. In fact, there is a secular decline in interest rates in spite of the explosive growth of overall indebtedness. And that is really a puzzle. Let me show you this. For the debtors and putting investors in the waiting rather than in the doing mode. Right? So inflation is very welcome to debtors because it unburdens them. In the absence of inflation, the debt becomes more burdensome. Wobei the experience and the anticipation of inflation incentivizes actors to act now rather than later. Deflationary conditions cause the reverse time preference. An extended period of low or negative growth and inflation generates the fearful yet self-fulfilling expectation that economic growth is not to be reckoned with. And as economic actors face an as constant sum game, they give priority to getting rid of their debt burdens, which otherwise would increase their economic vulnerability. Low real interest rates, as inaugurated by central banks' crisis response, will negatively affect aging societies. Now comes the demographic dimension of the problem. Aging societies, those with the declining proportion of the active population, age 20 to 64, in the total population. As the net return on savings and hence the capacity of the elderly to consume is diminished. With the consumer demand gaps caused by these mechanisms, anything approaching full employment seems out of reach. The rising level of unemployment and of discouraged workers no longer actively seeking employment will in turn decrease the level of potential output and unobservable economic entity that stands for the level of output that would result if all factors were to be fully utilized. For labor skills are perishable resources which vanish with their non or underutilization. Being out of work leads, in other words, after a while to the atrophy of skills, which may render long-term unemployed workers unemployable and effectively detach them from the labor market, while at the same time diminishing the economy's growth potential. This is an argument developed by Barry Eichengreen. Human capital, other authors, this way human capital depreciates off the job. As a consequence, economies undergoing an extended period of recession and unemployment lose some of their potential for growth. Given skeptical growth expectations of the real economy, the owners of financial capital will turn to buying debt, that is government bonds, rather than investing in the production of goods and services. A decline of rates of real investment, be they caused by negative expectations concerning demand in the case of private investment, or by perceived fiscal constraints and austerity cuts in the case of public investment, will also depress current consumption. For both kinds of investment, public and private, constitute not just future supply, but at the same time present demand that derives from incomes earned in investment goods sectors of the economy. Stagnation can also be explained, is being explained, by prevailing patterns of trends of income distribution. High levels of unemployment and precariousness, as well as partly due to both stagnating real wages, will reduce wage earners' capacity to consume. At the upper end of the distributional scale, earners of high incomes are likely to spend large parts of their incomes on other things than demand for consumer goods, namely on financial assets. In this situation, a massive progressive redistribution of income would help to stimulate demand because the marginal capacity to spend on consumer goods is much higher with low income versus high income households. Yet it is hard to see how such redistribution might occur exactly under conditions when it is most urgently called for. Economists trying to explain secular stagnation, such as Larry Summers and others, have called for what might be described as functional egalitarianism. Functional egalitarianism, an egalitarianism that is advocated not primarily by reference to terms of social justice or some notion of social progress, but in terms of boosting overall effective demand. Rising inequality, says Summers, operates to raise the share of income due to those with a lower propensity to spend. What is to be done, he asks, and answers by calling for, quote, a commitment to maintain basic social protections so as to maintain spending power and measures to reduce inequality and to redistribute income towards those with a higher propensity to spend. Similarly, Eichenfried suggests that the US must address its infrastructure, education and training needs, support aggregate demands to repair the damage caused by the Great Recession, and bring the long-term unemployed back into the labor market. This all sounds like a manifesto to reinvent social democracy. Yet given the secular decline and atrophy of social democratic political forces, it is a vital question how and by whom such functional egalitarianism based on policies of redistribution and protribution, as the new term is to be implemented. Is it at all realistic to adopt such policies? Labor market-related demographic trends are another factor that help to understand the dynamics of stagnation. Two simple indicators are crucial. One is the ratio, this is my favorite, one is the ratio of the international economy, of hours of gainful activity in the formal economy per year, divided by the product of 52 weeks, 40 hours, times population age 20 to 64. This sounds complicated, it's very easy, very handy, very useful. This is the labor force utilization index. It roughly tells us how many of the potentially available hours for gainful activities have actually been spent on such activities. The other is the ratio of the population age 20 to 64, the potentially active population, and total of at the total of resident in the total of resident population. This is the aging society index. Both indicators have a in for this. Okay. Working age population in the Eurozone. Annual percentage change, right? It's a constant decline from year to year almost of the share of the active population. Both indicators, so varying greatly across the OECD world, are in overall decline. As to the former, it will go down under conditions of unemployment, precariousness, in proportion to the share of established workers in the workforce. It is not just demographic aging that lets the workforce shrink in the US. In addition, there is a change that one author calls, quote, the US most worrying social trend, namely the 40-year secular rise in the number and share of jobless adults. An indicator of what happens if labor market education and social policy measures to fight exclusion, to use the European term, fail. If we slightly reformulate the aging indicator as population over 65 years of age divided by population 20 to 64 years of age, we get the following picture for Europe. The ratio of the retired population 65 plus to the working age population is projected to increase from 24% in 2000 to 35% in 2025 to 57% of the resident population 2100. The authors quite plausibly conclude that the rise of life expectancy combined with uncertainty about future health and benefits can be expected to lead to a significant further increase in savings per capita, that is non-consumption, but savings per capita both of workers and of the retired population. One of the economic features of aging societies, defined by declining birth rates and growing life expectancy, is that, as the German sociologist Christoph Deutschmann, among others, have argued, they generate a decline of the share of entrepreneurs among economic agents and correspondingly an increase in the portion of rentiers. What are entrepreneurs versus rentiers? Entrepreneurs use credits to invest in the production of goods and services, the profits of which are then used to service the debt and to finance further investment in large corporations. Rentiers, in contrast, are typically interested in a steady and reliable flow of income to finance their consumption needs, which, however, under low interest rates, that is, low yields of savings, are ever harder to meet. But Bookman, having postulated that the central bank, that's a wonderful sentence, but that's really to be taken seriously, and also in the present European world. But Bookman has postulated that, quote, the central bank must credibly promise to be irresponsible. He has relentlessly pointed out in his recent writings the paradox of virtue, a version of the ubiquitous collective action problem that we know in the social sciences. If I were to avoid indebtedness and live on my income without relying on credit, I act in a morally responsible and laudable way, following the role model of the proverbial Swabian housewife. Yet if everyone else were to do the same, the result is bound to be an economic disaster, as effective demand would shrink. The problem here is that the higher the level of indebtedness is already, the greater its burden and the risk that come with it, and the more irresistible the temptation to follow the precepts of what passes as economic virtue. Okay, in the interest of time, I need to cut this short. Consolidation, deleveraging, austerity, conditionality, these are all synonyms for conditions that cause the core problem for which long-term stagnation results. Effective demand is deficient and expected to remain efficient. To remedy that core problem of effective demand, the tools of monetary policy are no longer effective once real interest rates have fallen to zero or even slightly below. The crisis appears to be of an order of magnitude that incapacitates, I think that is my core argument here, that incapacitates the means by which it can be cured. A few years ago, political scientists started to launch the concept of state capacity or governing capacity. Perhaps we should rather adopt the language of policies running idle. And the point of happiness, this, has been reached when state capacity approaches a zero level, as it's resources of sovereign action and intervention are fully exhausted. A biological analogy problematic as always would be the ill-considered overutilization of antibiotics, which can possibly cause their ineffectiveness because they are resistant herbs. Given the system of capitalist property rights, as well as the recent experience of banks having to be bailed out, in spite of the moral hazard effects that bailouts have had on the financial industry, much more than on the states. Okay, given that experience, banks simply cannot be made to extend credits to debtors they consider unworthy of credit. This is contrary to property rights, right? These are all elements of the endogenous of why advanced capitalist economies tend towards secular stagnation. So this is a complex puzzle of several economic historical, demographic, labor market, and psychological components. They help to understand the rise of two macroeconomic disproportionalities. One is the disproportionality of savings and consumption. Given demographic, labor market, and distributional patterns and trends, too little of total income is spent on consumption. Instead, it is allocated to debt reduction and precautionary saving. A further increase in global savings will have a sharp negative impact on global GDP, says Eichner. The second disproportionality, that between savings and investment, intended investment that is, derives from the fact that given the consumption gap, the demand deficiency, planned investment lags systematically behind what would be required for an economic recovery and eventually and the labor force utilization. To be sure, financial investment capital is plentifully available at historically low costs. Yet a lower cost of capital makes little difference unless there are productive, that is profitable, projects to invest in. And these are missing. Psychologically speaking, there is not enough hope in investing. In spite of very low capital costs, while at the same time, there is too much fear on the part of economic agents, namely states, enterprises, and households, to make them desist from saving. Even a view of extremely low yields, savings can generate at prevailing interest rates. Quasi-social democratic warnings that both a more limited fiscal consolidation and a resumption of debt-financed government spending may be advisable, and they come from IMF representatives like Blanchard and others. Such quasi-social democratic advices fall on deaf ears in this situation, because the consumption and investment inclinations are not there. In order to heed such advice, Asians will have to be burned by a lesser level of indebtedness than they actually must cope with. Given the actual level, the perverse yet realistic response will be triggered that fiscal consolidation will remain a priority over government spending. High debt leads firms to investors and consumers to consumers. There's even highly unconventional monetary policies running idle, remaining ineffective. Extrapolating from the present policy quadrant, two kinds of responses come into sight. One is the idea of reducing interest rates to levels below zero, implying that acts of non-consumption of income would be declared economically punishable, thus establishing, as it were, a civic duty to consume. It is not clear whether such a policy bordering as it does on policy, a policy act of despair, would be legally permissible and or in view of the ensuing plight of the life insurance industry, economically tolerable. The other one, which is all over the place these very days, the other one, similarly exotic, yet creeping in the margins of the policy discourse, is the idea of helicopter money. Helicopter money, which dates back to a thought experiment by Milton Friedman. What conventional tools of monetary policy can affect is investment and exports, yet about half the GDP consists in consumption. And that is what helicopter money printed and dropped from helicopters, right, over the population, is designed to expand. It consists in a highly unconventional method, never tried anywhere, to combat deflationary tendencies by increasing the propensity to consume, by the central bank printing money, thus making purchasing power available to the population, without causing additional debt. One obvious question is, of course, why not adopt a basic income scheme instead? Right? It is entirely unknown how much cash per capita would be needed in order to achieve the intended effect of igniting inflation, and its hoped for consequences, and how the repeated, even routinized use of this policy device described by some commentators as the ultimate sin of monetary policy, printing money and dropping it indiscriminately over the population. Obviously, the repetition of this ultimate sin would be prevented. So this was the longest part, this was the endogenous economic explanation of secular stagnation. There's much to add. I'm skipping it. The other parts are much, much shorter. Let me summarize them briefly. Doubts in the future of economic growth based on technology arguments. This is an entirely new field, which for me, when I was studying this, it was full of surprises. And the history of productivity developments in Western capitalism is such that 3/4 of the productivity increases we have, we benefit from, the cumulative productivity increase we benefit from today, have taken place in the period 1879 to 1972. I must say that the, whatever you look at in a long-term perspective, the first half of the 70s is the watershed periods where everything changed internationally as well as nationally. You can put it in November 1973, the first oil crisis, but it's much more than that. Everything changed in that period. And what set in at that point, according to the very detailed data that Gordon provides, is a slowdown in productivity increases. There's only a short blip of productivity in increases, which is very short-lived and very specific and not spreading like the two inventions of the second industrial revolution of the electricity and the internal combustion engine, both inaugurated in 1879, within 3 months, right? This filled a period of 80 years with consumer demand, as it were. Right? But what happened then is negligible, with the exception of a short period of the electronics revolution in 1996 to 2004, according to the author, which made a short-lived and very limited productivity impact. No new technologies are on the horizon. What these technologies did is, in contrast to the second industrial revolution, not absorb labor, but replace labor. And also what they did is replace paid labor with unpaid, namely self-service labor. Right? You're spending many hours per week with self-service labor that no one pays for. Some of you may remember the existence of travel agencies, right? Or similar. This is all a matter of the past, unpaid. The blackout of productivity advances is the argument that's plays a role here. Briefly summarized. My third point is a paradox that social scientists like so much. By theories about the self-subversive nature of capitalist growth and those about the exhaustion of the technological basis for further productivity increases, both arrive at the conclusion that economic growth will not continue into the future of advanced capitalist economies, nor can it be restored by available means of monetary, economic, and fiscal policy. At the same time, there is an increasing number of voices that oppose economic growth, as if it were an ongoing process that needs to be stopped for its normatively unacceptable implications and consequences. The critics of growth, it seems, are insufficiently aware of the tendency of the object of their critique to evaporate. Yet it may also be the case that the logic of sour grapes governs the discourse on economic growth, and it is no longer to be had, let us reflect on the reasons why it is not truly, why it is not truly desirable in the first place. There are two kinds of critique of economic growth. One refers to external constraints, the arguments are well known. Mankind has become a geophysical force of the greatest significance. It has changed the biosphere in irreversible and very dramatic forms. Again, taking a long-term perspective, since 1800s, the product per capita has increased by the factor of 11, and the population, the global population, has increased by the factor of 7.7. And if you multiply these two increases, you see that the total production of goods and services that we have today is 80 times that of the year 1800, and that is not without consequences for all kinds of natural resources and the climate, losses of biodiversity, soil erosion, salination of land, extreme and devastating weather events, desertification, deforestation, overgrazing, overfishing of the oceans, threatening under prevailing nutritional habits and standards, the global food supply that is required for growing world population. So supplies of certain minerals and other raw materials are approaching the point of exhaustion. Man-made climate change, largely caused by the fossil sources of energy, with the greenhouse gases emissions, and the well-known consequences of positively life-threatening dimensions, with the undeveloped parts of the globe being much more severely affected by it than are the developed economies in much of the Northern Hemisphere. So this is all very well known to every reader of every newspaper. The challenge is due to an entanglement of a technical problem and a normative or political problem. The technical problem, in a nutshell, is the answer to the question, what measures are needed to reduce climate change to acceptable levels, and by when do they have to become effective, right? The normative question is this: which countries must accept, in the name of standards of fairness and global justice, which share of the burden of reducing their greenhouse gas emissions, and which other countries must be permitted to continue their emissions, and for how long, and at what level? How must the early industrializers compensate latecomers for foregoing some of the benefits of their catch-up industrial modernization and subsidize the cost of their climate change taking efforts? To the considerable extent, the economic growth cannot be uncoupled from its climate change and other environmental consequences. It must be limited in the advanced countries so that others can escape from their state of industrial backwardness. This logic calls for nothing less than a global rationing of permissible growth.
Yes. Okay, good.
Good, you remind me, yes. And how do we do this? I mean, this is, of course, the post-Kyoto discourse. What is a fair deal, given the fact that the impact of environmental destructions is uneven, and the degree of industrial modernization is extremely uneven, and neither can the Chinese say act as if nothing happens in terms of externalities of their modernization, nor can the OECD laws allow itself to be accused of pulling the ladder up behind itself, right? Denying to others what they themselves have done. Okay, one consequence, my fourth point of this debate is the very popular, but arguably misleading, engagement with green growth. We do not need less growth, we need different growth. And this is Offe's leader's response to the doubts deriving from external constraints. And that can be done through uncoupling, but this uncoupling can only be relative and not absolute. And so the constraints is pushed outwards. Again, a collective action problem comes up that can be modeled as follows. Another, perhaps an even more basic doubt about green growth. The first doubt about green growth is it sufficient? Is it a technology fix that may do something but not create what's called sustainability? Who is going to pay for it? Because these are the fruits of green growth are not individually purchasable. Right? They are collective goods that come into being through policy decisions and taxations. They are plain public goods, and who can be certain that the motivation of citizens rather than buyers and investors to support the production and pay for it sufficiently robust, particularly if it remains a matter of nations rather than supranational organizations. So these are all very unresolved questions. But the transition to green growth may be facilitated through a second kind of decoupling, very briefly. This is a decoupling that is captured by the so-called Easterly paradox, namely the more GDP you have as a person, the happier you are, up to a very low limit, as Robert Lane and others have shown. But that does not apply to societies, or in an even more limited way. And here you see, in German, unfortunately, the GDP per capita and the reported life satisfaction and happiness of people over 50 years in West Germany. And I mean, country after country and period after period, you have the same picture, but the two curves diverge. Societies get not happier with growth, individuals do up to a limit. Right? And this, of course, allows the speculation that perhaps what adds to our well-being is not more GDP per capita, but such things as rights rather than commodities. Rights and opportunities, and here is the point, of course, of the capability approach that has been very popular. The Manchester approach has plays a role. And that leads me to my last point, namely the point redefining well-being. And that is also a sort of concern themselves redefining lobbying. The first conservative appeals. My author and a very respectable author with whom I disagree, this is the German author, Meinhard Miegel, but you can find similar thoughts in the well-known book by Tim Jackson and others. Conservative appeals to reconsider a rose-addicted lifestyle. The message is you can achieve a state of well-being even in the absence of economic growth. Less can be more. This is indicative of the culturalist turn of the growth debate. What needs to be changed are the values and the notions of life and the notions of happiness. What needs to be reformed is not the economic system, but lifestyles, the cultural critique of consumerism that belongs here. This literature is inspired by what I call methodological elitism. It claims that things are as they are because people unwisely want them to be as they are. That they need to be re-educated, that is paternalistically enlightened and persuaded about what is really good for them. What methodological elitists make know of is that if people are found to actually approve of arrangements as they are, they may do so out of possibly well-founded fears for the jobs, like income, stability, certainty of conditions, rather than as a result of an unbiased consideration of available choices. People have to be converted to their true values, or so the discourse goes on. People suffer from a blindness, and this I quote from one of the books of Meinhard Miegel. They suffer from blindness, ignorance, addiction, ideology, thoughtlessness, a childishness of self-control, stupidity, hedonism, weakness of the weakness of political determination. The complaint is about the irrationality of mass behavior that drives economic growth, the blindness toward the future, both with regards to debt and to climate and environment. And the response of the authors is to sermonize on modesty and the adoption of post-materialist values. Emphasis on the character deformation resulting from consumerism. The conception of a better lifestyle is that social recognition must be expressed by other means than material rewards. People must be brought to communicate in a language other than what Tim Jackson calls the language of things, the language of consumerism, where items of consumption, including positional goods, do no longer relate to the satisfaction of needs and desires, but to the signaling of status and distinctive identity and individuality. People are being blamed for the stupidity with which they allow themselves to become addicted to consumerist lifestyles, for their irresponsibility with which they disregard the true values of human existence, such as family felicity, to which they also know deep in their heart they know better, unthinkingly and quasi religiously have come to prefer the shadow joys of ever new gadgets offered by the markets for consumer goods. People must resist the transformation of their desires into needs. What radical conservatives like Miegel advocate is nothing less than a cultural revolution of declining expectations. Policy recommendations of methodological elitists include warnings that the challenges of life in a post-growth society cannot possibly be resolved through redistribution and the granting of social rights. Instead, what is being recommended is wage moderation, a simple and austere lifestyle, and the rediscovery of the true needs as opposed to the imagined ones. The return to more labor-intensive modes of production, the deindustrialization of agricultural production, the voluntary performance of social services, and the revitalization of spiritual life. There is a culture of antiglots or postglots that is advocated, and it would, if it works this way, of course, operate on the demand side of the consumer markets. Now you have a different camp within this cultural term of the gloss discourse, and that operates on the supply side. There are two critical responses. One is critical consumption has become, and that is founded by social scientists, as an emerging mode of political participation. Coping with stagnation and making it sustainable through our own activity. The two arguments play a core role. Capitalist methods of production and consumption are wasteful. They are wasteful. And capitalism systematically and massively and visibly violates its own claims to efficiency. Whatever we buy, more often than not, it is the case that we buy and hence pay for more than we need. My favorite example of this, this is a little plastic stick that you will get on airplanes to stir milk or sugar in coffee. Right? So the physical characteristics of this is you use it for 2 seconds. Right? And if I put it here and no one takes it away, and nothing else changes, it lasts in its physical integrity for 200 years. So, it's made of oil, of course. This is one aspect of unneeded excess capacity. The standard automobile is a case in point. The capacity of a car to deliver use value moving passengers from A to B can be calculated as being 22 hours per day, 4 persons per 1 or 2. The actual capacity utilization of that passenger vehicle is perhaps 1 hour per day for 1.2 passengers. The rest is depreciation in the parking lot through rusting and technological obsolescence. So there are many other examples of this. This is being scandalized by movements and initiatives of critical anti-gross consumption. The other point of view is that there is a growing awareness of the asymmetry between the efficiency increasing potential of consumer households compared to that of enterprises. Enterprises control productivity developments. They design products for us. We do not design products or this delivery and provision of goods for ourselves. This has changed with the internet. We have much better market transparency. The point I'm trying to get at are the various movements, initiatives, models, which can be found in one place, namely the city of Amsterdam, very flourishing, of the sharing economy or the collaborative economy. Instead of buying things and owning them, you organize access without ownership of them. Car sharing, couch surfing are cases in both, but much more. Self-organized repair and maintenance, so as to extend the use time of items, consumer items. The awareness of carbon footprints and the decentralization of provision, the barter economy, the voucher economy, crowdfunding, donations, and similar examples for a new household economy that responds to the decline of employment urban gardening is an extreme example of food cooperatives. This is developing a subversive economic culture. To quote Barack Cannon, what began as a simple way of households to boost incomes has become a formidable disruptive force in economics. A subversive economic culture of self-provision that responds to and is itself a driver of economic stagnation. And it can be supported through basic income schemes, it can be supported through tax privileges for this new household-centered economy. The movement and the initiatives and the experience are there, and the future will show what they are good for. Thank you very much.